Welcome back to Bleh.
Final Fantasy What the Fuck.
Yeah.
Vocal sing-along karaoke?
Yeah, Joe, but this game has a boner for vocal tracks.
Oh, we're going to Serendipity.
Vocal tracks are fine, but
yes,
the karaoke seems a bit misfitting for this particular scene.
I think I would show to you how completely useless this particular...
Oh boy, is this the DLC?
No, it's not the DLC. That's the thing, Jova. There's a DLC where you go to Serendip and you actually do things with Sass. But in here, all you can do in the Serendip, if I remember correctly, yeah, this is the Serendip.
The only thing you can do in the main game are the slot machines and the chocobo races.
Yeah.
With Sass, you can start playing roulette and card games.
Poker.
Yeah. So, mini games are now DLC.
I mean, at least in the casino of Ni no Kuni, level 5 actually bothered to actually create their own card games. Instead
especially
of just...
because the poker and roulette card games are nowadays considering like the plague by the ESRB rating. So, of course, not only those are DLC, you also have an age restriction on them.
Really? You know, yeah. I never did get
where
this all
of a
sudden...
You know, sure, I give some credit.
That's the loadings are shorter. That's the reason, Jova, why they're not anymore in the poker games.
I do give that credit in the rare occasion
I get that,
it.
But I never got why all of a sudden.
Because you Americans have a fucked up sense of ESRB rating. Sorry, Jova.
And by the way, apologies to anyone who was maybe looking forward to it, but I'm not going to be doing any chocobo races because, quite honestly, I don't really like the chocobo races in this game.
Surprisingly enough, I never did them myself.
So honestly, by this point, I am so beyond caring that I just want to get this game over with.
And we're just halfway through, by the way.
Yeah.
Well, Dwarves is going away soon, so
well,
we have all
the
time in the world to cover
go,
this.
Chaotic.
Yeah, they're pretty chaotic.
Oh my god.
Interesting.
Okay.
Yeah, level 5 does this better. I'll just say that.
So, Pedro, how exactly are the chocobo races chaotic?
Okay, you want to do this one too, since I talk a lot.
Well, Jova, remember how they were handled in Final Fantasy VII?
Yes, you basically it was practically
with a
racing
camera
game.
Camera angle, but more clusterfucky. That's pretty much the same.
So basically, it's a matter of controlling the chocobo, but from a different angle?
Not really, you're just betting on a chocobo and that's it. You don't even have control.
Yep,
It's just a gambling mechanic and...
Yeah, it's like horse
racing.
So
you don't even get to actually...
Nope.
So you don't actually get to control the chocobo.
It's like especially because the shower races.
Wow!
In this particular game, the chocobo races are just chocobos. They do not have riders on them.
Yeah. Okay, Jova, just to give you an idea. Imagine the shower races. Imagine the shower races from the Sonic Adventure games, except you don't even have that thing where you can press A to, use some stamina bar. That's basically what the chocobo races are.
Just so you know, Pedro, that's actually... Yeah.
Go ahead.
You know, that sort of horse racing mechanic is actually a DVD extra on the Shark Tale DVD.
Yeah, he's
bad.
Right, it is.
That's bad.
So yeah, chocobo which were a fun diversion in Final Fantasy VII, and now been downgraded into a fucking DVD bonus feature.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, that's why I did a double take when I heard you say it's just gambling, because that is literally exactly the horsey racing in Shark Tale on the DVD.
Yes, and if I recall correctly, I know what the game is called.
And if I recall correctly, one of the fragments is not obligatory, but one of the fragments is obtained by winning and at betting.
Oh, look, they're doing the chocobo dance. How cute.
Meh.
Yeah.
Oh, so is this where Chocolina comes from? Because all the girls dress like
Java,
that?
Don't worry, Java. We'll get to Chocolina.
We'll have an explanation for that. Don't worry.
In the Sass DLC, we'll get that. Don't worry, Java. It's coming. It's coming.
What part is the Sass DLC?
In part 22, if I remember correctly. I think it's 22.
How many parts of this LP are there?
24.
Okay.
That's counting all the DLC that...
Wait, the Sass DLC is that close to the end?
No, Joe. Actually, no, it's not. Basically, as long as you've bought the DLC, And I'm guessing also in the PC version, though I never gotten that far enough in the PC version to notice. As long as you have the DLC bot, you can play the DLC stages right away from the beginning.
The thing is, Jova, as it will be told you a bit of time in the main game.
Okay,
the
chronologically, they never say it.
The DLC, it's right in the middle of the story because remember, wibbly wobbly timey wimey stuff.
Basically, Jova, you know how when you're selecting the various eras in the menu and it always says whatever AF signifying the year it takes place.
Mm-hmm.
All the DLC chapters have ?? AF, so we don't know.
So all right, you have to guess where they did.
Yeah. This store actually sells you can sell you artifacts. By the way,
basically, it's like the game corner from Pokemon Gen 1, basically.
Yeah. However, they operate on Super Mario Sunshine logic, where they literally sell you the MacGuffins that are needed to save the day.
So like, yeah, I'm gonna buy a wild artifact because STO can confirm for me, wild artifacts are your best friend in this game because most gates can only be opened with wild artifacts.
Not just that, they give you a lot of obtaining them. Give you a lot of crystallium points. It's not useful for you, Pedro, since you grinded. But for those who want to grind, they're your best friend. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I just realized something.
Actually, Tao, remember, I went out of my way to show off the alternate Sunleft waterscape where we see that flan scene that shall not be named until it comes up. So I actually did have to go out of my way to get wild artifacts. Go ahead, Jova, what is it?
You know, there is actually a chocobo riding mechanic in this game. We've clearly been using it. So, again, I ask, why is there no actual chocobo racing?
That's funny you mentioned that. One of the dummiest content is not actually what you said, but it's something that was very close to it. We'll get to that in a couple of parts, actually. Remember to remind me about this, because it's a bit important.
Anyway, remember how in Final Fantasy VII... we actually had a chocobo ranch, and we could actually get a chocobo near that area, and we could use a chocobo to travel to the world map.
I actually cared at that point.
Final Fantasy 15 is also going to handle chocobos in a similar way.
Oh god, this camera angle!
We also had a chocobo ranch in the demo, if you remember correctly, and in the full game, we're going to be able to get a chocobo from that. Square already showed us footage of the team riding chocobos. So.
No, we were talking yesterday about me getting that PS3. I might need a PS4 now, too.
Allow me to introduce the Mystic. Who is this? Yes, and I guess they figured they would have some choir song to make sure we know she's serious.
Actually,
business.
This is the Ragnarok theme from the first game.
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying that, because when I look at a character who looks like that, I think this song, right?
And no, she's not Chocolina.
Mystic is a...
She's just a palette swap of Chocolina.
That's what I was about to say. This Mystic is literally the same palette swap as like all the other NPCs wearing the Chocobo costume like that.
Jova, low budget. We have to reuse assets.
You know, there's low budget and then there's just being downright lazy. If you're going to make some Mystic this important, give her an outfit that actually stands out. Like, I don't know, make her look like a super Chocobo or a Chocobo.
Or try to do at least a bit of reference. Dress her up like Minwu from Final Fantasy II or something. Yeah. But we can't have nice things.
Allow me to explain what was written there. Basically, what the Mystic does is, every time you collect a specific fragment from the game, you can come back to the Mystic and trade for a specific skill. You know, remember that clock master ability that I used to speed up time?
Yeah.
That's one of the many abilities I can get from that Mystic character. However, since I used Game Genie to get myself all the fragment skills right from the beginning, because who gives a shit, to make my life easier, because I don't have to do any of that shit. But basically, all I have to do is go out of my way to do side quests to get those, basically. And since I'm not showing up any side quests anyway, whatever, I'll just use Game Genie for that.
So let's see, just to do a recap.
That's it for Serendipity. Since I'm not going to play any Chocobo Races, we're done. We'll be back here in Sasa's DLC.
So, just to recap, for that level, we had terrible camera angles. For the fun level, Chocobo Racing, that well, bottom line sucks. Oh, and I am still questioning why there is no actual chocobo racing if there's actually a chocobo riding mechanic.
Oh boy. Jova!
Allow me to say something. Allow me to say something before Teo starts explaining.
Oh boy.
I hate this era. I hate this era. I hate this era. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it.
I don't blame you. Okay, Jova. Remember in the last okay. Pink, you said you complained about the fact that Cie'th didn't seem to be affected by time travel bullshit and stuff?
No. What I'm saying is, like, well, apparently if you are a Lissy, that does affect you. And I was wondering how it
like
affects
that.
Cie'th.
Well, it's kind of like what it's going to happen. Question, do you like Resident Evil?
I used to, but...
Depends on which Resident Evil we're talking about.
I mean, in terms of having a video game setting of a zombie, random zombie apocalypse right in the middle of a big city.
I used to be a casual fan of Resident Evil, but then
I liked it
happens.
Back in the day, but the concept nowadays has been run so much into the ground, it has to be an amazing game.
Basically, Jova, you're about to get Resident Evil in a Final Fantasy game.
Pretty much, yeah.
So wait, everyone's a Cie'th now?
You're close.
You're close, yeah.
Also, weird credits!
And more pretentious narration by Lightning.
Weird, this future doesn't look too badly, right?
Looks like
then where is Lightning?
The Star Wars prequels.
She right. Sarah's our main character.
Hey, wait
Don't
a
question
minute.
It.
Hey, wait a minute. This looks like the city that never was.
Don't worry, She-Roy. We'll have plenty of Lightning in the next game. Don't worry.
Oh, boy.
There you go.
I can hardly wait.
Oh, yeah. Notice the incredible sarcasm in Shiroi's voice.
How do you build this? We Brits are known for that.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Deadpan snarkers found most often in America and Britain.
Mr. Toriyama and Mr. Daisuke Watanabe, the co-writer, could you maybe, you know, try to give this chick some kind of personality? You know, aside from the fact that she's Lightning's sister and she's engaged to Snow, could you give her some reason for me to give a shit about her?
Oh, but Pedro, don't you know? Her being Lightning's sister is all the reason, because Lightning's so wonderful, isn't she?
Oh, yeah, of course. I forgot. Okay. I stand corrected.
So, Shiroi, my care cup is a little empty. Do you think you could fill it up with something?
Live the good life in the off-world colonies.
Tea? that's kind of my answer to everything.
Question two: have you seen Blade Runner?
Yes, but this was a long time ago.
This is Blade Runner.
Done badly. Look at that! It's raining, but so you can cry in the rain. Metal Alchemist did this so much better.
Also, that.
Oh boy, here we go.
Also, that thing.
Wait,
where,
what are we doing?
That thing where we saw Noel shed a tear. Let's just look in a March suit did that thing better and I don't know that.
Okay, Shiroi, apparently it turns out that this particular future is controlled by a falsy that actually human created. Yes, apparently humans were that stupid when they created a falsy on their own, despite the fact that the falsy ruined their life in the past. And now since the falsy detected some strangers, as a measure of defense, turned every fucking single person in rage into Cie'th. Reason whatsoever.
So why are we helping them?
So yeah, Shiroi, what's that you were saying about you not believing that this game could get even worse?
Literally, we are in a time that's canonical, by the way, according to the timeline. It's not an alternate timeline. This is the actual timeline of Final Fantasy XIII, where basically humans were too stupid to be a falsy that can easily screw their lives just for a simple mistake.
I think I'll just try to enjoy the wild ride for the remainder
of
the place.
How do you even?
Yeah. Okay, Shiroi, allow me to explain this in a way that will make that will be easier for you to understand. Imagine if in Kingdom Hearts 2, the scientists were trying to create a clone of Ansem from the first game. That's basically what they're doing That's basically what they're doing here.
It's come to think of it, it's kind of like Superman and Earth's End. They made two clones of Hitler. Why? Because!
Oh yeah, Shiroi, that's an interesting thing. There's a comic called Superman and Earth's End, which is a post-apocalyptic comic book where the world went to shit because some dumb scientist thought it was a good idea to make twin clones of Hitler.
Well, whatever happens then is your fault.
All right, so I sped up things up because if I didn't, this part.
If I were these guys, I'd say fuck this future because so, they were all idiots.
Allow me to say right now, audience, there's going to be quite a bit of editing and speed up using the Clockmaster ability throughout this part, because if I didn't do that, this part would be like 5 hours long.
Oh boy.
Basically, Shiori, that remember that remember that look at that 45-minute thing on the video.
Yep.
That used to be much bigger. I'll just say that. That used to be much bigger.
Okay.
So basically, now also the defense system is active. So that means you also get the security robots along with the zombies. Because why not?
Honestly, here's an interesting thing too. I never even bothered with this thing because it gives me more monsters to fight, aka more CP. So whatever, I'll just bust through. Whatever.
Apparently Chocolina is one of the survivors. Psst,
Teo, remember, she's a time-traveling merchant. Shiori, remember in the first game where we had those big monsters called the Fall Sea who were basically ruining life for everybody else and we had to destroy them?
Yep.
So yeah, that's basically what they're doing. Basically, Hope and his team of scientists were trying to create some kind of technology to keep up the new cocoon afloat so that they could create a new cocoon to replace the old one. And he thought the best way to go about it was to create an artificial falsie with an AI, and he didn't at all think that maybe this falsie would turn against them.
That's well, to be fair, that's something a character like Hope will do.
True.
Oh my god!
More and zombies.
And that's the problem. This setup may be cool on their own if it was done better, but doing like this, it's completely stupid and wasted.
Well, Teo, isn't that kind of this trilogy's tagline at this point?
This is literally a waste of money, effort, and time.
Yep.
They could have been working on something completely new.
They could have the time that they spent making these three games. They could have spent more effort and money than trying to get 15 completed faster. And
how many years did you say these three games span?
4 years.
Yeah.
Unless the first
13 was announced in 2006.
Hold on,
and...
let me ask something too. You mean like the time that they came out, or like from the very first announcement of the first game up until the time the last one came out?
The announcement to the last game.
So in that case, from 2006 to 2014, which would be 8 years.
Jeez.
Yeah, Shiroi, for 8 years this thing plagued basically the Final Fantasy franchise. And reminder, Square actually did very little for the other franchises they were having at the time.
They
so
spent
for
a
while, this is all the shit we
on
got.
This shit.
Yeah, but basically, Shiroi, while you were enjoying Kingdom Hearts, we had to deal with this shit.
Oh,
and
well,
yes,
I'm,
another
I'm
thing.
Sorry.
The Cie'th keeps spamming right basically next to you, so you have to constantly fight them, which is not a problem in saving because they're weak, but they're just annoying.
Yeah.
Like incredibly
Thank
annoying.
You. The problem is that okay, the encounter this is another reason why I don't understand why they brought back random encounters again. Especially because the random encounter frequency in this game makes Final Fantasy IX's random encounter frequency be amazing by comparison. I mean,
Okay,
you made the advancement in 12 where you removed random battles, and you kept that in 13. And you decided to bring this back in 13-2. Why? What's the point of intentionally going back to a dated mechanic? The random encounter mechanic is outdated. It doesn't belong in today's market anymore. Okay, fine. Pokemon is still doing it, but Pokemon does it in a specific way where it's not annoying, because it only does it when you're in caves or in the grass.
And then you have cases like Bravely Default, where you can even customize at your preference.
Okay, basically, sure. In Bravely Default and Bravely Second, those games still had the random encounters, but here's the big difference with those games. Those games have a special meter that you can adjust, how often the random encounters are. Meaning, if you put it at zero, you will never run into any monsters except for bosses. And if you put
of
it...
Co-
And if you put it at 100, basically it's like one encounter per step. So if you need to grind, put it at 100. If you don't want to bother with monsters, just put it at 0. Or if you just want a normal experience, just leave it at the middle point. It's however you want. But this game now, let's bring back the old style random encounters, even though they suck. Oh, another game that did this better, as Theo can confirm for me, Rogue Galaxy. Because the random encounter mechanic in this game pretty much works like Rogue Galaxy. The big difference is that in Rogue Galaxy, basically, in case you don't know, Rogue Galaxy was Level 5's final PS2 game before they went independent. In Rogue Galaxy, it has random encounters. But here's the big difference. In Rogue Galaxy, even if monsters pop up in front of you, you can just keep running and completely ignoring them, and the game will allow you to just run away and completely ignore them. In here, unless you're lucky and you manage, and the mock clock takes mercy on you, because I still have no idea how the hell the mock clock works, you're forced to fight every monster, especially in this area, because in this area the mock clock might as well not even be there.
Yeah.
Ugh. Okay,
cutscene. I guess he has to reflect the situation, but yeah. And yes, more zombies and shit.
No shit, Sherlock. Hey, Shiroi, guess what? There's people all around us. What does that mean?
We're surrounded.
Yay!
Basic logic. Woo!
And also another interesting thing: you cannot actually recruit Cie'th like the other monsters. So even fighting them, and they don't give you a lot of CPs.
Hold on, cutscene now. So. Anymore, so why don't you show yourself?
Caius. Oh, hi, Caius. Pretend to capitulate and buy yourself
time. It's not a bad strategy. What?
You've got no reason to fight
me, Caius. What the hell does that line even mean? You are
contradictions in the time. It means objection.
I need evidence.
So yeah, Caius is accusing us of being contradictions in this.
Why are we evidence of us being contradictions?
He's literally operating on logic on the anti-monitoring countdown to Final Crisis.
Okay, I'm back.
Why do
what
we have
I
to
miss?
Kill someone? Jovi, because we're a contradiction in the timeline.
Just, basically, yeah, Caius has appeared and he's accusing us of being contradictions in this timeline. That he's tired of us constantly traveling for time and changing history, because that's dangerous and shit.
But isn't
Jova,
he the source of all the history changing
the
in the first
but
place?
But trust me, Jova, a lot of shit is going on.
Well, actually, Jova, the source of the time travel that's going, the time distortions thing, is actually not been revealed yet, so you have to wait on that.
So it's not him, but
No, that's the thing, Jova. His goal is actually to stop us from time traveling. His goal as a villain is actually completely different than you're expecting. They haven't revealed his motivation yet, so you'll have to wait on that, sorry.
Isn't he technically doing
thing,
the right...
This particular score we are hearing...
That's just the thing, Jova. This guy's the one doing the right thing, and yet we're supposed to side with the others.
Also, this score we are hearing, which is a remix of Caius' theme, looks like it's straight up from the Star Wars prequels. I'm not even kidding.
If there's one thing in the prequels that did definitely was as good as the original trilogy was the music. John Williams' music was awesome in those movies, to be fair.
No, I know,
so
but
exactly
the style. And wait until we get to another, not spoiling yet which track is, but there's a track later on, but there's a specific segment that literally seems like it came out from Batman. I'm not even kidding.
Okay, Jova, you're probably wondering
what exactly is the gimmick of
this
area?
Jova. You explain, Pedro.
Well, first of all, I have to answer Jova's question. The gimmick of this area, Jova, is that the random encounters are incredibly frequent, and as a result, fighting monsters in this area is incredibly annoying.
Now, what about this particular time era, you know, this particular future?
Basically, Jova, here's what happened. Remember how in the first game we had the Falsi, which were basically our main source of problems?
Yes.
Okay, Hope is trying to create a new cocoon to replace the old one, so that people can go there.
What? Why?
Remember, Jova, a cocoon will fall eventually, so we need to find a solution, an alternative.
Remember, the world comes from a future where a cocoon fell, remember? So Hope decided to start, you know, working on something to avoid that, but wait a minute, cutscene. So.
You just said that.
You just said that. Redundancy.
Well, what's to say you aren't?
Actually, they are.
Yeah, they are.
Oh, so they are! So, yeah, they're causing nothing but trouble.
Our heroes?
Why exactly are they doing this again?
No. Job, remember, we have to find Lightning.
And basically, Hope and his team of scientists thought it was a good idea.
Hold on, I was the one explaining it, so hold on.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, okay, Jova. So yeah, the Falsi were our main problem in the first game, right? Okay, so Hope wants to create that new cocoon to replace the... So that he can save... So that after the new one falls, we can catch it and prevent it from, you know, destroying things by falling. And at the same time, create a new cocoon that will basically return people to civilization and not have to live on Pulse, right?
So he's trying to recycle the old cocoon like that.
No. Well, science, Joe, but that's not the big problem. Here's the big problem. Here's his method. Here's the best method he thought possible for creating a new cocoon. He thought he would create an AI to run all the computer science for him. And how does he accomplish this? He creates an artificial Pulse to run things. And guess what? That artificial Falsi turned against humanity and destroyed everybody. And this is the future that's the result of it.
Basically, Jova, as soon as we enter this timeline, the Falsi got triggered and turned every single civilian in line into Cie'th.
So yeah, we're
defend itself.
We're ripping off the Terminator, basically.
Wow. Oh, Pedro, this whole thing reminds me
of what happened.
Hold on, Shirai. Go ahead, Jova.
Okay.
And again, this is apparently the fault of our hero, since them showing up is what alarmed the Falsi.
Yep. Yeah.
Jova, there's...
Wait, but... then why don't they just leave?
Remember, Jova...
They have to find the gate.
Remember, Jova, Lightning specifically told Serah to come find her. So we have to find Lightning, so therefore we have to travel around the timeline until we accidentally find her.
So literally, the only reason there's a sense of conflict, the only reason the world and timeline are in danger, is because Lightning went missing and Serah... Wait, actually, was Serah time traveling actually the reason Lightning went missing in the first place?
No, actually, no. But don't worry, when Lightning reappears in the plot, she'll explain everything, so... Anyway...
But again, the main reason for Havoc is Serah and no going looking for Lightning. Glorious.
Exactly. Shiro, you...
At least with the first person game... Oh, never mind.
No, go ahead.
No, Shiro, you were about to say something about... you said, Pedro, this is starting to look like something.
Oh, it reminds me of something I saw in the news this morning. I think it was Microsoft that created an AI that could use social media and learn from it. Unfortunately, it backfired when the AI started posting racist, sexist abuse on Twitter.
What?
They talked about it on the news this morning, and it had to be pulled.
What was it called?
I can't remember what it's called. Microsoft.
Isn't that the same robot who said he wanted to exterminate humanity?
I don't know.
Because the original Christian made a video about that.
Really?
Yeah. Anyway.
I don't remember that part, but yeah, they wanted it to learn from people, and they connected it to social media, which wasn't a good thing.
So yeah, Jova, as I've explained to Shiro so that she could understand this easier, this is the equivalent of Ansem in the second Kingdom Hearts game trying to create a clone of Xehanort's Heartless.
See, here's the main issue I have with our quote-unquote heroes in this game. At least in Final Fantasy XIII, yeah, the heroes were doing dumb stuff. Yeah, they could have easily avoided some stuff. But at least, at the very least, they did have saving Cocoon in mind, and they weren't purposely going out of their way to just try and destroy Cocoon.
Jova,
they were actually having some sixth sense that they were trying to protect.
Well, the thing
but
is,
these two...
Well, actually, Jova, allow me to say something, though, then, because, to be fair, I didn't explain this to you properly. See, the thing is, as of right now in the story, we don't know who's in the right. Either Serah and Noel or Cie'th. Basically, Serah and Noel think they're doing the right thing because Lightning told them to do this. But Cie'th keep telling them that this is the wrong thing to do. But Serah and Noel are assuming that Cie'th is just trying to trick them, you know? So the player is supposed to, you know, think, okay, Cie'th is the villain, he's just messing with us. But then, at the end of the game, it turns out Cie'th is the one who's right. True, we got ahead, so sorry about
that. I'm actually not surprised, I hate to say.
If you think I've just ruined the big plot twist of the game, believe it or not, no, because there's an even bigger stupid plot twist after that.
Yeah.
If I can give some credit, I mean, that is actually a unique, well, okay, a somewhat unique idea. Yeah. Although I have to say, I kind of saw it coming. However, yeah, I mean, it is an interesting plot point, I guess.
The problem is that it's in the hands of these people.
Yeah, and like I said, it's like, well, you know, like, well, unlike the heroes of Final Fantasy XIV, these two aren't even considering that they might actually be the Paradox themselves.
Actually, that's the thing, Shiroi. It's not Shiroi, bad. That's the thing, Jova. This game is destroying my brain. That's the thing, Jova. There's some points in this game, and I think at the end of this chapter, if I remember correctly, Serah sometimes monologue, are we doing the right thing, Lightning? Could we maybe try to find some way? But that's all that they do. They just wonder, maybe there's something wrong that we're doing, but then they immediately forget about it and just keep doing what they're doing.
By the way, awesome. A bit of a warning, Pedro grinded so he has no problems, but if you're doing this level on your own for the first time, be warned, this is actually a super boss in disguise.
Yeah.
Really?
Wait, in the main game?
Jova, normally, without having grinded to a maximum level.
Okay, it's two things. Basically, Jova, this game
is... So you're saying
trying...
that you're not supposed to beat this one?
No, you are.
You actually have to avoid this one.
Yeah, you are, but... Yeah, but the thing with Jova, my guess is the reason they put a super boss so easy to come by, unlike most super bosses, I guess they wanted to go back to a more old school thing where in JRPGs where you can find super bosses just by snorkeling the street sometimes. But I don't know. It's still.
So
don't worry. If you come across this battle and you lose. Don't worry. You literally didn't got any single penalizing for losing anyway. You can just press retry and go back straight to before you fought him. So it's not like it matters if you lose, right?
Yeah.
So does defeating the super boss change anything?
See, I got 5 stars and I didn't get shit. I didn't get jack squat, and I 5-starred the fucking battle.
Wow, 5 stars and no reward.
That entire
battle. At least the first part.
That entire battle was a complete waste of my time. A complete waste of my time.
At least in the first 13 game, you at least got a reward. You did.
Teo.
Yeah?
You explain this, because it's beyond me.
What am I supposed to explain? The fact that Dayami gives you real loot? It's a thing since 12, I think.
Okay. I'll be fair. To be fair, Final Fantasy IX had a similar problem where, for reasons that I still don't understand to this day, the boss battles don't give you XP, and I never understood that.
Yeah.
That's the one thing in an otherwise good game.
In a couple of Final Fantasies, they had this trend of bosses not giving you XPs. XP points.
I never understood that.
It was for people who wanted to make low level run, since bosses are mandatory for the story.
I guess, but I would rather.
Although
they just
in that case,
it
should be a different game mode nowadays.
Yeah, I would rather they just do what some other games do and include this. One thing that Kingdom Hearts does really well that I like is one of the abilities.
Yeah, the zero XP ability.
Yeah. Just apply that to a Final Fantasy, and there you go.
Oh, but Pedro, don't you know, if we apply anything Kingdom Hearts to Final Fantasy, it must be burned.
Oh yeah, of course. Sorry, I forgot about that. No turn-based, 0 out of 10. Ruined forever. Well, like I said, like I've already explained to Shiroi, there's a good reason why the fanbase is so bitter to that change.
So, Pedro, is Hope dead in this future, or
yes,
just
yes.
turned into...
We're actually going to see exactly what happened to him by jumping into another time that it's connected to this one.
Yeah.
But keep in mind,
go ahead.
This is not, despite having a paradox here, this is still supposed to be the canonical future of the timeline, not an alternate timeline like it was in the Asta Mashif with the eclipse being.
And by the way, Jova, notice how this part is 45 minutes long. That's because, as you probably realize by how many battles I've had for this part, that's because this part takes a ton to. There's a lot of jumping of speeding up the game for the Clockmaster ability and some editing that I did. Otherwise, if I didn't do that, this part would be like 5 hours long. This,
I think I noticed why. It's because, like, well, here's what this game does. It cheats you. It can literally turn NPCs into random encounters. Mm-hmm. From what I've seen, I mean, there are people who, like, will, you know, go, there are some characters who will be harmless NPCs, but then, boom, they can just get turned into a Lassie.
That's exactly what happens. The Falsie is detecting you as strangers, and he's turning, using people as basically human shields, mimic shields.
That's one of the worst things an RPG can do if not prepared correctly. I mean, seriously. You can't just, all of a sudden, launch...
setting on his own is a good idea. It's interesting to explore. However, in this, since this is this game and we can have nice things, it's done very poorly here.
Tell me about it. And the spacing, dear lord, of all the places for you to have NPCs that can turn into Cie'th on the fly, you choose this area where it's actually can be very narrow,
but
hard to maneuver.
But don't you see, Jova, remember how in the first game it was all hallways? Now we have an incredibly confusing maze that it's incredibly easy to get lost in. There you go.
Alright, is it the boss time now?
Yes, it is.
So, question. This artificial intelligence fallacy, is it as powerful as, say, the likes of Bartendalus, who could also turn
Well, if the boss battle is anything to judge by, not really, because the boss battle against the fallacy is incredibly easy.
Yeah, we're gonna
let me get this straight.
Go ahead.
But
does this mean that any normal fallacy could literally have turned anyone into a Cie'th on the fly? Because I thought it was only supposed to be the incredibly powerful ones.
No, this is a special gimmick for this one, because it functioned as an AI.
So, AI fallacy can just automatically turn people into Cie'th? Okay, seriously, this game needs...
And reminder, people built that thing. Someone actually constructed that fallacy with that specific command in mind and say, let's see what this policy can do. Oh, I know. Let him make turn people into Cie'th as a defense mechanism. That's a good idea.
You know,
basically, they created a computer.
Time paradoxes, but is this even more of a paradox? Because, like, well, you know, like, well, the Falsi have prided themselves on being the makers, the gods, and everything.
But yet humans have now been able to make that. The Falsi itself is the paradox, not the.
Okay, Jova, you were hoping to see anything. They're gonna attempt to make you care about this character. So see if you care. Let's test it then.
But we already know he won't.
Yo, bitch.
Okay, basically, Shirai...
But sorry, I care Osome very, very, very much. From the bottom of my deep, deep heart.
Anyway, Shirai, this is to catch you up on what we're doing. Basically, they created a computer, and somebody thought it would be a good idea, just for the hell of it, to have the ability, to give that computer the ability to turn people into zombies. Because why the fuck not?
So, Pedro, you know what this means, right?
Are the people in this future stupid? Like, completely stupid.
After we're one game and a half into this trilogy, and you're only now just asking that question.
Hey, Pedro, I've been asking it in my head throughout.
Go ahead, Jova. Go ahead, Jova.
So this means that all the talk about the Falsi being gods above humankind from the first game is complete horse crap. I mean, seriously. Humans have now shown that they can not only make a Falsi, but a Falsi that has the ability to turn people into a Cie'th on the fly. I'm sorry, but that just completely invalidates every single boastful thing Bartendalus had to say about the Falsi being all powerful.
There you go, Jova. Remember in the first part where Taylor warned you about that? There you go. Now you know.
And knowing is
half
the battle.
Yeah.
The first game never existed. You can just start here. The first game never existed as far as the rest of the trilogy is concerned.
Anyway, Jova, since we're actually fighting the boss, Jova, remember that thing I mentioned you about that optional super boss for the first game that was comically defeated by a Tomberry?
Yeah.
Now we're fighting
him. Why is she
here? No reason, just to bring a dummy content into existence.
Not to mention Jova.
Kind of function like Ruby Weapon from Final Fantasy VII, but in a more weird way.
You see, by the way, Jova, since you
That's
also...
an insult to Ruby Weapon.
That too.
But yeah, I see where you're coming from.
By the way, Jova, since while you were gone, me and Tay also explained to Shiroi about how the random encounters are incredibly obnoxious here. and we've brought up how the random encounter system in this game is pretty much the Rogue Galaxies, but done horribly.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like I said, though, it's like, well, in this particular area, I actually think that, you know, like, well, the random encounter is at its absolute worst, because turning NPCs that are harmless at first into monsters right on the fly is just... Okay, you have to do that smartly.
It's like if Kojima
want people to get easily pissed off.
It's like if Kojima made a Metal Gear game and took away the ability to crouch down. You know, yeah. you know that one mechanic in Metal Gear 2 that completely added a lot of depth to the stealth.
Even Snake's Revenge had the ability to crouch.
Well, in the 2D sections where there's no stealth to begin with, but sure, whatever.
Well, you know what I mean. It's like, Michael, even Snake's Revenge remembers to do some things that can allow you, albeit very poorly, but still allows you to. This game, on the other hand, just says, huh, random encounters. Who needs that? Let's make them immediate encounters, no matter what you do.
And now,
we finish with a quick time event, because why the fuck not?
You see, sure, there you go. This is the kind of RPG gameplay that you probably could play. Just press the just press any button you see on screen.
Wow, look also at how awesome Serah is.
Wee! Yes, throwing your weapon, because always works.
One thing they could have done, well, then again, it wouldn't work because this game is not action based in the combat system, but
depends, Rachel, what do you have in mind?
One thing they could have. Maybe somewhat made this better if they try to make it a little more like the reaction commands from Kingdom Hearts 2, because those they were not deep in gameplay yet, but they were more fun because of the way they were performed. You had to press only triangle, true, but the way they did it was much more visually appealing to look at.
And if you fail, there were some reaction commands
that did require some bouts. Yeah. And there were some reaction commands, granted I think they were rare, but there were some reaction commands who used
Question, Shiva, Jova, have you ever played the optional super bosses from Kingdom Hearts 2 Final Mix? I'm guessing not, right?
No.
Okay, basically...
Yes, I have.
Oh, you have? Basically, Shiro, there's an extra world in Kingdom Hearts 2 Final Mix, which you will be able to get when you get your PS3, where you can fight super powered up versions of the organization for team members. And some of them are hard as balls. Some of the times there will be
some
reaction...
Some of them have even attacks that bypass once more and last chance. Not even kidding.
Yeah, basically, Shiroi, in the reaction commands are one of those things where if you don't get it, like, for example, let's say, remember that battle against Xemnas in the clock tower where...
Oh, let me...
Where you have to use the reaction command at the right time to do the most damage. Well, in that game, the timing is much more difficult. And if you don't get it right, you'll get a lot of damage. So, basically, bring your A game into this boss, or you're fucked.
Oh, jeez. Yeah.
Basically, to tie this back into this game, unlike this game, the reaction commands, while they are simply pressing triangle, do have about a strategy to them. Like, well, you can't just simply mash triangle and hope that the reaction command will always go through. Yeah. I mean, like, well, in cases like, well, the fight with Zigbar, yes, you can use triangle to dodge, but if you just spam it rapidly, you're gonna get shot a lot of times in between then.
You're essentially playing a rhythm game.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah, basically, you will have to die because Raisin stares at some of the dubs, and now he's like, come on, let's move on.
Yeah.
If I can piece this together... Serah and Noel are pretty much causing a genocide of Yules by messing up the timeline.
Exactly.
Yep.
And they don't care.
Huh.
Technically they do care. They still feel sad every time one of them dies. But it's not like they're doing anything to stop this. They just feel sad.
Okay,
that makes it okay, I guess.
Okay, yeah, it's official. I like the heroes of Final Fantasy XIV downright better, because these two are actively killing, and they are now aware of it.
Imagine if Hitler tried to justify the fact that he killed millions of people by saying, I'm really sorry and feel really bad, you guys. Can you please forgive me?
But I'm looking for my brother.
I'll tidy your rooms for a week, I promise.
That's basically it.
It's like, okay, we'll give you a slap on the wrist.
It's like, seriously, this is despicable. I mean, we went from, like, you know, six misled heroes trying to save Cocoon to these two who are now knowingly and willingly killing ULs just to try and find Lightning.
There you go. There you go.
And there's no consequence.
Hold on, listen here. Listen here. Hold on. Basically, that Cie'th was apparently a fake or something. There you go. I don't know. You're never going to explain. I forgot the rest of the game, so how am I supposed to?
You know, Pedro, just now I realized you had a wasted opportunity. You couldn't use that clip from South Park: The Stick of Truth where the big bad government guy goes like, "Oh, I hate zombies. They're so overused."
You're right, actually.
Well, I guess to be fair, they're technically not zombies.
At least we're justified the in-game since they were in the previous game, at least.
Okay. Well, that part was a doozy.
So yeah, Jova, the first game isn't looking so bad anymore, is it?
No, not really.
You know, I mean, we already reached that point earlier, but now it's gotten even worse.
It's amazing how
I mean,
you'd think after the first game, okay, this is it. You cannot possibly stoop any lower than this. But Motomo Toriyama, the man who somehow manages to completely top his awfulness with every game.
Anyway,
go ahead. All right, see you, everybody.
See you for the next part.